Okay, I call this presentation Seated at Lorenzo's Table because the 2 weeks we spent with farmer chef Lorenzo Polegri in Orvieto, Italy was every table that we went to belonged to Lorenzo. He's just an incredible person. So we went, six friends went. We spent 2 weeks with Lorenzo, almost from mid-morning to 9 at night. It was just the experience of a lifetime, working with him in the kitchen, learning from him, learning his cooking styles, shortcuts, and we visited so many places and learned about the ingredients that were used and the ingredients we used in our dishes. So here's the group, and you'll recognize some familiar faces, Patricia Akiyama and David Larson, who are actually traveling in Canada, so they couldn't join us tonight. Penny Schwartz and me, and Patty Fernandez, Penny's friend, and Mary Jean Machetto, who I think is here tonight, and Lorenzo. So how did this all start? So in 2018, Penny and I and a friend of mine, Peggy, went on a tour of Sardinia with Andy Aldrich. And here this photo is in Alghero. And this was in La Voce a while ago that Andy submitted. And after the tour was over, Peggy said to us, "Oh, my friend in California told me about this incredible guy who teaches cooking classes in Orvieto. And she just couldn't stop raving about him. So I signed up for a day of cooking." So we said to Peggy, "Oh, sure, tell us how it all went." And when she got back, she said, "I can't tell you how great it was. He's just super and it's just so much fun." So Penny and I checked out Lorenzo's website and decided, well, this sounded pretty good. So Lorenzo Polegri was raised in Baschi, which is a really small little town right outside of Orvieto. And he was the owner of Ristorante Zeppelin in Orvieto. And by invitation, he cooked several times at the James Beard House, as well as cooking for President Barack Obama in the White House in 2010. Lorenzo is associated with numerous culinary schools throughout the US and also in Puerto Rico. So this is just the cover of the agenda that he sent to us. And as you can see, it was just over a year ago that we completed this with Lorenzo. So this is not really meant for you to read, but it is meant for you to see that our days, every day, were filled for the whole 2 weeks. We went all different places. We had two long cooking classes scheduled, but after the second one, we were driving in the van somewhere, and I said to Lorenzo, "We have so enjoyed these classes that then every time we had a free afternoon, he would say, 'Oh, what do you guys want to cook? You want to come back to Zeppelin with me and we'll do something?'" And of course, we always did. So we must have had six cooking classes with him. It was incredible. So just to give you an idea, Rome, here's Orvieto, where the restaurant is located. Here's Baschi. And these are some of the places that we visited while we were there. And it really doesn't include a lot of small towns because I ran out of space. But everywhere we went, we sampled the food, the local food. Lorenzo would buy something and bring back. So we went as a separate trip to Bomarzo, which is has the Park of the Monsters, Civita di Bagnoregio, Montepulciano, Radicofani, Montalcino, Diruta on our way up to Emilia Romagna, where in the area of Parma, we visited Langolano, Viviano, and Caviago. So here you have the local market in Orvieto, where we went with Lorenzo. And the market is there for two mornings, 9 to 1. And the color is what just grabs you when you look at this. And Lorenzo, of course, has favorite stands that he goes to buy produce. And one of the interesting things is, can you see the scale this lady is using to weigh the produce? She's got a counterbalance, and that's how she weighs, and then she determines the price. Incredible. So here was a stand that had mostly cheeses and some salumi. And one of the interesting things is that when you look at the cheeses, they're basically all pecorino. And that is the cheese of the area of Orvieto. So here we are. This is where we started our adventure. So we had our own table in part of the restaurant. And Lorenzo's restaurant is not your typical restaurant. It's not open to the public. It's open to tour groups and for cooking classes. So there's a special table where if you were part of, you know, a cooking group, you ate here. In back of David was the actual restaurant itself. And in back of Penny and Mary Jean was this demonstration area for those of us who signed on for a number of courses. And if you went to the left, looking here behind Lorenzo and Eliza, you'll see that, well, you can't, but you will later. There's a very long kitchen, and that's where really a lot of the prep took place to prepare for these tour groups. And also, once we graduated from the demonstration area, we got to work back there as well. So here we are, one of our parts, once we graduated, to the long kitchen that has more ovens, a huge stove, sink, freezers in the back, is we're making risotto one night. And first, the way it went is that Lorenzo would demonstrate his skills and then turn it over to us, and we would try to emulate it, successfully or not. Putting the rice in, and here's the risotto that we had, a saffron risotto. It included onion, guanciale, which is pork, a part of the pig, broccoli, porcini mushroom powder, and what we were to discover, the super secret ingredient, fennel pollen. So who would have known that fennel pollen would add such a unique flavor to a lot of dishes? And it was really multifunctional. One could use fennel pollen on many things. Here's just a bit of the risotto. We also, with every meal, had wine, usually from Casa Segreta, which is where Lorenzo lives, and he has both olive trees and grapevines. We always had a red and a white, and we often started the meal with Prosecco. And I have to say, I mean, we had all the courses, typical courses, that after the first few days, we just asked them when they plated our meals to plate less, because it was just way too much food. So on the next slide, you've got Mary Jean, who is taking some lumachelle off of the baking sheets, and they're a bit like a roll. One of my favorite was tozzetti, which are biscotti, although made in Umbria, therefore tozzetti, and usually made with hazelnuts. And I have actually made all different tozzetti since I've been home, just because they're fun and I can actually do it. We made a gnocchi dish. We always had dessert, and not just a dessert. We'd have a gelato with pasta frolla, the dessert pastry. We'd have some sort of a torta, and then just a little au garni on the side. Here is preparation, a topping for some cauliflower soup that we were making. Again, the topping had the pork, the guanciale, tomatoes, fennel pollen. And this was an evening that was actually one of the most exciting for me of the whole trip. We had been with Lorenzo that day and we came back, and usually he had three interns from the US who were there to learn from him. It was a paid course of 3 to 4 months. And they usually did a lot of the cooking for the tour groups who came. So one night we're there and he's got a tour group coming of 25 people and none of the interns show up. Actually, there were four. So we had started cooking with him, and then Penny, Mary Jean, and I were in the kitchen and said to him, "Do you need help?" So he said, "Yes." And he looked at me and said, "Okay, I need a sous chef. You're it." So for the evening with Lorenzo, I was a sous chef, making the cauliflower soup, putting the toppings on. We had a sort of conveyor belt where we put everything together. First, we'd done the antipasti, then the soup, and then Slavic and Alessa would serve. And while we were preparing stuff, Lorenzo was doing a demonstration of making pasta to the group. And so afterwards, Mary Jean and I did finally get to eat. And then after, at the end of the tour with the tour group, Lorenzo would chat with them a bit, ask them, you know, if they had any comments. And then he called me out and introduced me as his sous chef. And that was, for me, one of the highlights. This is another plate of vegetables we made, just red peppers, but seasoned perfectly. This was actually made at Casa Segreta, Lorenzo's house. And yeah, vegetables never tasted so good. And adding the red wine never hurt. So here we have our first, one of our first adventures out, and we went truffle or tartufi hunting with Giovanni and Chris, the dog. So it turns out that truffles, which are mushrooms, really like to grow in certain places, and they need a certain type of trees. And these include oak or cedar, willow, hazelnut, and a lot of shrubby type vegetation, not just big dense trees. And as it turned out, who would have known, I imagine some of you do, that Umbria is the single biggest producers of truffles in Italy. And in the winter and summer, and we were at the end of summer, it's usually black truffles that are found. And then in spring, it's white and biancheto. So we followed Chris and Giovanni. And here you can see Chris in action. He just would dart over, sniff out a truffle, dig it up or push it up with his nose, put it in his mouth, drop it, and Giovanni would give him a treat. And at the end, we were, Chris got really clever because he'd pick up a truffle, he'd give it to Giovanni, he'd drop it, get his treat, pick it up right again, but Giovanni was wise to him. So here's our harvest. I think we actually ended up with something like 22 truffles. And along the way, Lorenzo had spotted these mushrooms. So he collected mushrooms. When we went back, we made a pasta and truffle plate for dinner, which was incredible. And for years, I've said that I didn't like truffles because I guess all I ever had was a plate with truffle oil in it. And that is not very pleasing, but it turns out I did really like the truffles a lot. So that was eye-opening. One of the other places I really enjoyed was this very, very small winery right in Orvieto called Svinere. And it was founded by Veglia. And to this day, they still use the recipe of Nonna Veglia. And the husband of her granddaughter still runs it with his friend Paolo. So Ivano and Paolo run this little winery. Here you can see there is a big bottle from which we filled our own individual small bottles. And you can see Patricia's got her bottle there, and she's using this instrument to put the cork in the bottle. Before we bottled, we actually had a taste of the wine, and it's made with viciole, or wild cherries, in the Orvieto area. And a few of us thought that it tasted like a port. So we had samples with a bit of chocolate or biscotti. After we put the cork in, we went to another room and we did our own seal on the top of the bottle and then put on our own label and sealed the seal. And then we all got our certificates from Svinile. But this was just perfect because we did go to several wineries, anywhere from huge to medium. And having done this visit where we did it ourselves with a bottle, it then was so much easier to see in these giant places where it was all mechanized and automatic. But I mean, the theory was still there, except they didn't use wax on the top of the bottles anymore. So here's an adventure we had at Fattoria Secondo Alto Piano with Emanuele and Alessandra. And they have a goat farm and they make goat cheese. So here's the goat who wanted to get to know everybody. You can see how friendly he was. And Emanuele and one other person, they grow the food for the goats. They don't buy it from anybody. They have land to grow it on. They breed the goats, one male to 25 females, and they alternate males, alternate years with the males. And they end up making about 47 different varieties of goat cheese. And you can see some of them here, and you can see the shapes and the sizes are diverse. Sometimes there are coatings on the outside, sometimes not. They can be either soft or hard. So it's quite a variety. And here we actually had a little hands-on session where we could, we mixed up the cheese from the curd and then put it in these forms to set. At the end, we had lunch at Alto Piano and we had all some of the cheeses that they had made here, and of course, wine. A very lovely place. It was a real treat. The next adventure was with Maestro Amadeo, the butcher in the forest. So if you're squeamish, look away. Amadeo, right here, received the pig carcasses from customers, and then he would cut out the different cuts of meat, whether ribs or chops or roasts. And then with the outside, he would stuff it, and they were making a dish called porchetta, which the only place I used to see it when I first went to Italy was Orvieto. But now you can actually find it in other places. Actually, the last time I was there a year ago, I saw porchetta for sale in Rome. So what this is a stuffing of the porchetta, and it's stuffed with organ meat from the pig, liver, heart, other things, and fennel, and then secret seasonings. And everyone who makes porchetta has their own balance of seasonings. So nobody tells you exactly what it is. And here's a secret seasoning tray from Amadeo. And so here the porchetta is put in an oven for a long, slow roasting, and then at the very end for a short time under high temperature. Amadeo also dried meats to make prosciutto or other dried meats. And you can see there's this substance at the end. And before they're even dried, it's a combination of lard and salt to cover the sort of opened non-skin areas to, as an antibacterial, especially. And then it just dries and gets darker as it goes on. Okay, here we had our adventure, seeing how bufala mozzarella was made at Farm Luisa in Monte Fiascone. Sorry, I have to take some water now and then. So it turns out that bufala mozzarella is much higher in protein and calcium than regular mozzarella, and it's also lower in cholesterol. So we were lucky enough to visit the farm where there were actually bufala there. And it's one of the few bufala farms outside of southern Italy. Most of them are in the south. We walked in, and one of the first things we saw outside were two guys, each with a wheelbarrow, and these little calves whose heads were just hanging over. And we thought, oh my gosh, they're dead. But they weren't. They had just been born. They dumped them in here with these obviously friendly bufala. And they were trying to figure out, you know, who the mom was. Do I know this person? But that was a treat. They had just been born. So here we could look through a window and see how the mozzarella was made. And there's a curd that is then broken up through this machine. The curd is heated here, and as it's heated, it gets thicker and thicker, and then the cheese is shaped, and it can be shaped with a machine. And here you can just see little mozzarella balls coming out, going into brine, or one can, once this cools a bit, but not much, it was still hot, they would do twists of mozzarella that look like a big rope, and then they make it in a pretzel figure. Afterwards, it's stored in brine for up to a week, and will be sold by then. And in here, there was a little store where they sold all the different sorts of bufala mozzarella, some of it fresh, some in brine, some smoked. And there was a ton of activity, a lot of people coming in to buy the mozzarella. Keeping it in the cheese vein, as you saw from the map, we headed up toward Parma to the north and to see how, in this case, Parmigiano was made. And we went to L'Atelier Sociale Pavarotti in Viviano. And this is a start. The art of making Parmigiano was based on generations and generations of artisan cheesemakers. And it's actually pretty simple. It's made of cow's milk, salt, and rennet, which is an enzyme. Parmigiano is produced exclusively in the provinces of Parma, Reggio Emilia, and in places, specific spots in Modena and Bologna in relation to the two rivers there. So the food that the cows eat is strictly specified, as is the process itself. So any other place producing Parmigiano, it's produced in the same manner. There are no additives or preservatives in the Parmigiano. So after the evening milking, and this is not, you can't see it here, the milk is put into a long vat and just left there overnight. In the morning, the milk is skimmed, the cream is skimmed off of it, and it's added to this vat with milk from the morning milking. And you can see that this is a copper kettle. What you can't see is that it's bell-shaped and it goes down really far. After the milk is all combined there, the rennet, the enzymes added, and curds start to fall, and then they're continuously broken up as they form. Then heat is applied. The curds, all that are broken up, all sink to the bottom, and they form sort of one mass. This mass, after an hour of heating, is then removed, unstuck from the bottom with a special paddle, which I didn't get a picture of, and then up pops to the surface this big, if you will, curd or big blob of Parmigiano, which is then captured with great skill into some cheesecloth. You can see here that he's cutting this into two, and this, it's the size to fit into a series of molds. So in the first plastic mold, you have a band, a marker band, that will be placed on the inside. And in that band is engraved the month and the year of production, the factory registration, and different inscriptions to determine, to indicate what the Parmigiano is. And you can see here 210 on this one, that is the number of Pavarotti. So any wheel of Parmigiano you see with 210, you know it's from here. In the same way, when you see that number, you're able to trace it back to see specifically where it's produced. After staying in this mold for a while, it's then transferred to a metal mold. And this metal mold is then immersed in salted water. You can just see the outline down there. And it stays there and it's immersed for a while in a saturated, so high salt solution. And the salt goes into the cheese. It's removed and then stored minimally for 12 months. You can see that this is a newer round. This is an older one. And there are stacks and stacks and stacks of these molds, these rounds, wheels. And there's a machine that goes down each row and it turns each one of the rounds or wheels. It inverts it 180 degrees every day. So how do you know when it's ready? How do you know when it's worthy enough? So this is Davide, and he was our tour guide while we were up in near Parma, because although he's a journalist, he also works with different tour groups, and he could interpret because his English is perfect. So he's going to do a little worthiness testing here. And there is an official hammer right there. And what the person does is tap all around the surface of the wheel, and they're listening to the sound. If there is a hollow or a place where there's no cheese but air, you will hear a different sound. And then that wheel is not a first grade wheel of Parmigiano. And it will be sold as a lower or medium grade, which means there were some minor to moderate defects. And usually then they're left for a total of 18 months before they're sold. So this was, you know, you just see this and you're surrounded by these wheels. It's incredible, actually. So also while up north, we stopped in Longarano at Fii Canetti Salumificio to see how prosciutto was made. So prosciutto is made from the thigh or the hind leg of a pig. And there is a series of salting rooms that each of the prosciutto go through. And it starts, it's refrigerated, a low concentration, low percentage of salt. And then after a few weeks, so over a period of months, it gets transferred into a second refrigerated room with a higher percentage of salt. And what the salt does is twofold. I mentioned before with Amadeo, it's an antibacterial, but it also removes any leftover blood that is within the thigh. So I have to say that those of us who were walking around instantly noted how these hanging prosciutto had little faces on them. And it was somewhat distracting as you're walking down these rows and these little faces are staring at you. One of the ladies who worked there also was walking with us, and when we said this to her, she laughed and said she'd never noticed that. So it just shows you what your perspective shows you. So here again, you see this large salt covering on the prosciutto. And you can see in these pictures that it darkens up as it dries out after the salting. And the white lard turns dark. It's still got a little covering. And one of the final steps right before it's released at about 18 months is that you can't see it well, but there's this little metal rod, and the owner who brought us around, he sticks that rod in near the bone and then he sniffs it. And what he's sniffing is to see if he can smell any blood. And obviously you've got to have a well-developed nose for that, which he's probably practiced a lot with. So here's our group. There were a few less of us, but the owner, Lorenzo Davide. This is Brendan, who was one of the culinary interns that was with us on the trip. You can see we're all in our little protective coats. And it was cold. I mean, we had our coats on under that. So also up near the Parma area, we stopped in the Acciaio Pici to see how balsamico is made. And I really liked this little design on the outside. So the balsamico is made out of white Trebbiano grape must, which means finely crushed grape juice with the skins, with the seeds, with the stems. That's called the must. This must is boiled and then put into a cask. And then over time, liquid is transferred from cask to cask. And you can see the sizes of these casks vary, large to small. And the casks are usually made of chestnut, juniper, mulberry, oak, and cherry. And again, the process remains the same to produce balsamico, although things like the casks, the type of wood you use can change, and the timing of the transfer can change. And also something that is totally amazing to me is that there's no temperature control. So a lot of these casks are in the upper level of a building where it gets really hot in the summer and really cold in the winter. And this seems to just be the way that balsamico likes to be produced. And as you can see, these are not sealed. It's open, so there's evaporation. And as the evaporation occurs, the material is concentrated and more rich in flavor. So at a sequence that the owner knows, you transfer out a quantity from the small cask, and then it can be tested to see if the taste is right and it's ready for selling. And then you replace the liquid that you took out from the last with the bigger cask. So you transfer. And you do that until you get to this one, where you then add some of the new Trebbiano heated musk that you've done. So here's, I mean, this is just a little part. There were floors and nooks and crannies of these casks. Different ages. You can see these are somewhat newer because of the brighter bands. These are older. This is the owner of Peachy, and this is so cool. So this is a beautifully ornate grate. It is locked, and only he has the key, because behind here is some of the vintage balsamico. And I assume that his wife knows where he keeps the key, but somebody must. But he's very proud of this. So the product is monitored by a consortium, and they control both the production and the labeling, and all of the producers in this consortium use the exact same shape bottle. And there's also another consortium in Modena, and their bottle is slightly different shape, narrow neck, and then it's rounded at the bottom. You can see these are the different grades. The red is aged at least 12 years. The silver, at least 18 years. And then the gold is aged over 25 years. So I did. I bought one of the silver bottles. And one of my favorite antipasti is to have Parmigiano with just a little balsamic drizzled over it. It's totally incredible. And it's easy. And I'm all about easy. So we went so many places with Lorenzo, and it was just impossible to have a slide for every place. But we had so many more adventures, and we enjoyed a cooking class, a candy making class at Perugina Chocolates. We had a lesson. We each had our own station to make chocolate truffles of our choice. There were all sorts of ingredients. And let me tell you, it is not nearly as easy as you would think to make these little chocolates in these molds. We also visited a farm that had both Chianina cows, the white cows, and Cintacenese pigs. And these are the cows from which the Florence Bistecca are taken. Very high quality meat. And then this is a special pig that is usually just found in this area. And they look in Orvieto. We're back to Orvieto now, or thereabouts. And it looks like when you see them, they have on little pants and a belt, hence the cinta belt. And here we went to this. This was fun. This was a place called Radicofani. It's a fort, a fortezza, and it has this incredible view. It's up on a hill overlooking the town of Radicofani, and it overlooks the Val d'Orcia. And this fortezza is also called Castello of Ghino di Tacco. And Ghino di Tacco in 12 or 1300s was an outlaw of the region, but he was also a hero in that he was a bit like Robin Hood. So they have inside the fortezza, they have a room that's got the history of the fort and of Ghino. Very fun. One evening, we went out to Lorenzo's home, Casa Segreta, and we had dinner there. He barbecued steaks on his outdoor barbecue. We had a simple salad and those red peppers that you saw early on. And of course, wine. And we had an angel food type cake for dessert. And I forgot the name of it. Sorry. We went olive picking, had a stint at that. Not Lorenzo's olives, but a nice orchard. It we set up for us, the nuts are already there. And you just take your hands and you run them down the branch, and the olives, the stems, the leaves all come off. There's also an instrument that they have that they can reach up high into the tree to shake off the olives. And, but you know, it's more fun for us to just all attack a tree. And we were all around there. And then we moved the net. Lots of fun. So we did visit the Parco dei Mostri, the Park of the Monsters, a park dating hundreds of years back. Yeah, probably to the 1300s. And there are these gigantic sculptures of monsters, or sometimes mythical figures. And it's just, you know, you feel so small when you stand there. We did a number of winery visits. I chose not to show that, since most of us living in the Northwest here have been to some winery now and then. But it was fun to see. Ivano, who owns Sinere, also works at one of the bigger wineries. So we got a nice visit there, including the lab where they do quality control, which was fun to visit. We were out driving one day between adventures, and it was 2 p.m. and we had not eaten, and we were just absolutely starving. And we were in an industrial area, I don't even know where. We finally said to Lorenzo, okay, look, the next place we see, we have got to stop because we are really hungry. And there in this little Italian strip mall was this place called Italian Burger. So we stopped and we had one of the greatest burgers I've ever had, with fries. And it was made half and half, Chianina beef and other half non-Chianina. So just a little review of the group. Lorenzo, of course, who was always clowning around. Mary Jean, me, Patty, Slavic. And there were 4 interns, Gary and Jerry, although I can never remember who was who, David and Patricia, Brendan and Luis. And Alessa's not here. She's the only one who didn't make it into this picture. And then just to show you, we actually ate at the grown-ups table in the actual restaurant. Here we are, Lorenzo, as usual, at the head of the table. And the group here with the interns, and I think the interns had done a lot of the cooking that night. Again, bottles and bottles of wine and water, and Lorenzo always at the head of the table. So one of the things I want to do is thank all the people who gave us this incredible adventure of 2 weeks. And certainly the major one is Farmer Chef Lorenzo Polegri. And then to my friends, the group of 6 adventurers who were basically ready for anything to share. Cristiano Castaldi was the guy who took photos and who did filming, including with a drone. And he randomly came with us during our daily trips, but then he traveled with us up to the Parma area. And that was the first chance I'd gotten to speak with him, because he actually spoke no English. And it takes me a little bit to put myself out there, but we ended up chatting and just really enjoying each other's company, and we still write. My thanks to Slavic and Elisa, who were at Ristorante Zeppelin, and all those people who we visited, who opened their doors to us and shared their passion for the products that they made and for the history of what they did. And thanks to my daughter, Kelsey, who started it all with me going to Italy. So I am going to try to show you a video. It's silent at the beginning, don't worry. Thank you.
corri di amore vai. Hai negli occhi gli occhi miei. Vai con questa mia canzone, intrisa di emozione, il mondo aspetta il tuo sorriso, vai. Blu, il cielo è ancora blu. Tu coloralo di più. Vai in questa confusione, milioni di persone, il mondo è vuoto se non ci sei tu. Vai, sei bello come un re. Sì, bello come il ritornello di questa canzone che io canto per te. Ma si nasconde anche il dolore nel dolcissimo rumore della vita intorno a te. Fai la tua strada fra la gente, falla innamoratamente come quando eri con me. E allora il cielo è ancora blu, tu coloralo di più. Vai con questa mia canzone, che è intrisa di emozione, infonde al mondo la felicità. Vai, sei bello come un re. Sorridi e prendi il volo, se un dì sarai solo, io sarò qui per te. Ciao, sorridi e prendi il volo, se un dì sarai solo, io sarò qui per te.
There we go. So, it turns out that Lorenzo had been thinking a year ago of doing something a little different. And I think with COVID, it just was good timing. He closed Ristorante Zeppelin in Orvieto, and he now is building on his land at Casa Segreta, a smaller restaurant. And this is his house. This is where we had dinner that night. This is where the barbecue was. So he's building out. This is in July, and they've gotten a lot farther since then. They've got structure, and they're putting in the sinks and the infrastructure. And he imagines that this will be open in the spring, and he will again hold his cooking classes, either a few hours or days, or you know, a week or two. And this is Lorenzo with his son Tommaso, Tommy, and Tommy does a lot of the farming and the overall farming there. And Lorenzo is, I mean, he is such a people person. He's amazing. He just loves people and they respond to him. Here are olives from the olive pressing that is just ending now within the last few days. Here are some Sangiovese grapes that harvested to make wine. And if you're interested in the classes, this site still is in existence, and it will tell you about the cooking classes, although the restaurant, of course, as I said, is no longer operational. So, grazie a tutti. I